Sir, coming to the prevention of diseases, is yoga useful in preventing diseases? And what is the science behind it, sir?
Yes, yoga is in fact more beneficial or more helpful in preventing than in treating disease. And now, in fact, the basis is on a more sound scientific footing. As we have seen in the last few minutes, yoga is not just a set of physical practices, and it doesn't just help us in improving the performance of the body, it also improves the performance of the mind, and it makes us peaceful, gives us peace. Now, what has happened in the last 30 to 40 years is that there has emerged a new science which we now call psychoneuroimmunology. This science has proved a bridge between the subjective and the objective. You know, what happens in the mind is subjective, but the changes in the immunocompetence of the person are objective in the sense that you can take a sample of blood and measure the immunocompetence of, say, the white cells, and then you can express these results numerically and analyze them statistically. So you have objective results in front of you. What has been found is that psychological changes, which are subjective in nature, have physiological effects which are objective and which can be measured by measuring immunocompetence. So if a person is going through chronic stress, his immune system becomes weaker and makes him more vulnerable to all types of illnesses. Not only infectious disease, but even heart disease, diabetes, and cancer have immunological counterpart. The immune system, the derangement of the immune system can contribute to allergies, of course, that is obvious, but apart from that, also to heart disease, diabetes, and cancer. And therefore, now we have the mind-body connection known between such a wide variety of illnesses that gradually it's being felt there's hardly any disease to which the absence of mental peace does not make at least some contribution. And and it's a two-way street, it's not a one-way street. Just as stress can contribute to all these illnesses, being at peace can help us recover from these illnesses. And that is again true not only of self-limiting diseases like common cold and diarrhea, it also applies to chronic disease like heart disease and diabetes.
And sir, what about, can you give some examples of some incurable diseases that can be treated with yoga, if not completely treated, but prevented and can lead towards
uncure? Yes, the way yoga looked at in a comprehensive way can help an incurable illness like cancer is at every level, starting from prevention to palliative care. At the level of prevention, it helps us by strengthening the immune system. Now, briefly, I mean, what does the immune system have got to do with cancer? Cancer is essentially a group of cells dividing extremely rapidly. Now, this is something which has gone wrong with the cell cycle. You know, normally we have a very delicately balanced cell cycle, so that the number of new cells formed is exactly equal to the number of cells that are dying. So it's a replacement process, and these new cells formed are of the same type so that they can perform the same function as the cells which have died. But then this delicately balanced process can sometimes be deranged, and the cells can multiply much faster than the cells that are dying, and these rapidly dividing cells are generally also functionally poor. They cannot function like the normal cells, and this is what we call cancer. Now, when this process of derangement of the cell cycle has just begun, the immune system of the body is capable of identifying these cells as non-self, because that is how the immune system functions, by distinguishing between cells which belong to the body and which don't. For example, germs don't belong to the body. When they enter, the immune system takes care of these germs by eliminating them. Now, these abnormal cells, which are dividing very rapidly and are non-functional, they cannot perform the functions of the normal cell, are also sufficiently different from the normal cells of the body to be identified by the immune system as non-self. So the immune system eliminates them. But suppose the immune system is weak, then what happens is that it's not able to eliminate these cells, and their number grows so big that now they are beyond the competence of the immune system anyway. And that is when the person gets a full-blown cancer. So in fact, perhaps this type of a beginning of a cancerous process is taking place in all of us a lot of the time, but we don't even know about it. We remain blissfully unaware of it because just as soon as a few such cells have formed, the immune system eliminates them. And therefore, the weakening of the immune system can contribute to the development of a full-blown cancer. And there is enough evidence to show that traumatic events of life within a few years are followed by cancer more often than can be due to purely a chance. It's not purely because of chance that that happens. Now, once again, it's a two-way street. It helps not only in preventing, that is, if we are able to practice yoga in a comprehensive way and therefore achieve mental peace, it will help in strengthening the immune system and that will prevent cancer. But it also helps in treatment of cancer. And this is something which was observed very clearly by a cancer surgeon, Bernie Siegel. He found that some of the patients, after he has operated upon them, overcome cancer completely. And this can happen because the surgeon now, by removing much of the tumor, reduces the cancer load, and whatever remaining few cancer cells are still in the body, they can then be eliminated by the immune system if the immune system is strong. So that's how surgery in certain cases with cancer can work as a total cure. So he found that this is happening only in a few patients. And then he found that these patients are not those who have a different type of cancer or the cases in which the diagnosis was perhaps wrong. These are different type of people. These are people who have a certain psychological makeup. And the chief characteristics of the psychological makeup were, firstly, that these people had a fighting spirit. They didn't say that, well, the doctor has said that you'll probably live for about a year more, and the doctor is God. Those who believed so died on schedule. Whereas those who said, the doctor is not God, I'll prove him wrong. They had a fighting spirit. These were the ones who ended up living longer. Second thing that these people had was that they did not focus their attention entirely on the disease. Instead, they said, well, I have got advance notice now. Let me try to do all those things which I have been postponing so far, all the interesting things that I wanted to do, but I had not been able to do them so far. Now let me do them. So they go about doing, sort of finishing all those things which they thought were very interesting and important to them, but they had been postponing. The third thing is that these people had in common was that not only their attention was not focused on the disease, their attention did not remain focused even on themselves. They in fact became more loving and caring. They started taking interest in the problems of others, much more than they did earlier. And they tried to make up in their relationships. If they had hurt somebody, they were very quick to apologize. If somebody had hurt them, they contacted that person and, don't worry, we are friends again, I've forgiven everything. I've forgotten and forgiven everything. And in this type of a situation where the person has cancer, these people also, their friends and whom they had hurt or who had hurt them, they also responded positively. And the result was that they ended up having a big circle of love around them. They were drowned in love, and this seemed to make a big difference. So these people, in spiritual terms, actually broke the ego barrier between themselves and the others, used that illness to do that, and the spiritual growth that they achieved in a few years was more than what one can achieve in several decades of ordinary life. Not only that happened, these people ended up either overcoming the cancer completely or lived much beyond the expectations of the doctor. So in that sense, yoga can contribute to the treatment of cancer. But then suppose still the person does die because it's not a magical cure or sure shot thing, and the person may not die of cancer, he may die of something else. That's also possible. The person does die, then the person can die more peacefully because of yoga. So as I said, it can work all the way from prevention to palliative care.
Sir, being a medical doctor, can you throw some light on how yoga can be integrated with modern medicine for cure of diseases, especially those which are very serious?
Actually, it not only can be integrated, Yoga has been integrated with modern medicine now for a long time. Dean Ornish did his experiments on heart patients sometime in the 1970s. And if we take that as a landmark, it has been done for a long time, the integration. And what this integration means has been, I think, very clearly stated by Larry Dorsey, who has in fact divided modern medicine into the era of physical medicine, which came to an end around 1950. And after that began the era of mind-body medicine. And of course, he has talked about something else also, which is coming, but we'll not go into that. But yoga certainly has great relevance to this era of mind-body medicine. Because what mind-body medicine means is that we can use the powers of the patient's mind to heal his own body. And when it comes to the using the powers of the mind, one of the most important things is that the person should not only have the confidence in the doctor and the treatment that he's taking, but he should also have confidence in the capacity of his own body to heal the illness. And he should be mentally at peace so that these self-healing mechanisms can work at their best. So that is where yoga comes in. Yoga gives the self-healing mechanisms of the body a chance. And that is how it becomes a very important tool in the practice of mind-body medicine. Because one of the most important things that the person needs is to have this confidence that my body can heal. But then this confidence alone is not enough. His self-healing mechanisms should be in top gear. And they are in top gear only when he is mentally at peace. And that is where yoga helps. And so yoga used as a mind-body approach has been integrated into modern medicine. And some of the pioneers in this area have been, apart from Dean Ornish and Bernie Siegel, whom I already mentioned, and Larry Dorsey, our very own Deepak Chopra, and many others. And these people are all doctors who have basically trained in modern scientific medicine from some of the best medical colleges in the world. And then out of their own interest or through the observations that they made in their clinic, they have taken deep interest in ancient Indian wisdom, particularly yoga, and they have brought it in as a mind-body tool into modern medicine. So in that sense, now modern medicine, according to Larry Dorsey, has added a new dimension. The spectacular advances that were made in the era of physical medicine through the discovery of vaccines and antibiotics and the discovery of insulin and anesthesia becoming safe and so on have not been thrown away. Those were very valuable. And it is those advances that actually raised the life expectancy in the Western countries in the 1950s, and it is those advances which have raised our life expectancy in this country also since independence. At the time of independence, our life expectancy was hardly about 30 years. Today, it is more than 60. So these spectacular advances in physical medicine have helped. But then modern medicine has now added a new dimension to it, and that is the mind-body approach. So in that sense, the yoga as a mind-body approach has already been integrated into modern medicine.
Sir, my final question to you is that how do we promote yoga among the youth? What is your message for the youth of today, sir?
I think the best way to sort of promote yoga among the youth is to show them that we are not telling them to exchange an interesting life for a dull and monotonous life, which yoga is sometimes identified with. What they have to be shown is that yoga is something which gives you the best version of happiness. Happiness is something that we are all looking for. And it is something which does not require renunciation of ordinary life. You can keep doing the work that you are doing, but then you can bring greater joy into the work that you are doing. You can do that job much better, and you can be healthy and happy, much healthier and happier than you are now, and make life much more interesting than it is now. Make life such that your happiness will no longer be dependent on external circumstances, to experience the type of life that is independent of external circumstances, This is the key.